Hi, hope you are doing well. This video is part of the Citrix NetScaler core skills training that I am doing. In this video, we are going to cover Zendesktop Gateway configuration and we'll go into all the details. The agenda is, first we'll configure the storefront load balancing along with LDAP load balancing, which is very important. And then we'll check the DNS requirements, certificates requirements. Then we'll actually do the configuration, which is a wizard driven. Then after that, we'll go into all the components which the wizard has been created, and we'll go in deep and we'll see what's happening in each one. Then we'll create a custom theme, and after that we'll understand the session policies, and in the final a general requirement from most of the customers how to do security hardening for the URL, right, VDI URL. We will do that. These are my environment details. You know, I have two LDAP servers, 192.168.2.1, 2.2. And I have two storefront servers, 216, 217. I have one controller, 215. You might have any number of controllers. You can add all of them. It doesn't matter. I have one for now. The LDAP load balancing virtual IP is 212. As we know that most of the people don't do LDAP load balancing. They just will use one of the domain controllers. And if that goes down, you know, users cannot access VDI. So to avoid that, we will load balance the LDAP. Then we'll load balance the storefront servers, which is 213 is the IP. Then after that, we'll configure the NetScaler gateway for VDI, which is 214. My URLs are this: storefront URL is sf.ssllab.com, and for VDI, NetScaler gateway, it is VDI. By the way, I'm using two different URLs. It doesn't matter. If you want, you can use only one URL, VDI also. Only thing is, if you are using one URL, the base URL of the storefront and the DNS record, which is on the local host of storefront, should point to the NetScaler gateway. And as you know, in the NetScaler gateway also, you should create a record. I'll show you now. Now let's go into the configurations. I logged into my NetScaler. I'll go to the traffic management, load balancing and servers. As I said, first we'll load balance the LDAP servers. Click on add. As you know that we have two LDAP servers, two storefront servers. I will add all of them here. We had created one, similarly create others also. Now we can see here, we had created two domain controllers, two storefront servers as servers. Now go to the service groups. Create two service groups, one for storefront, one for LDAP. Click on add. For LDAP, just provide a name and select the protocol TCP and say OK. Now select the service group members. Server based, select the both the LDAP servers and provide the port as 389. That's my LDAP. Let's say if you are doing 636, which is the LDAP S, you can select that here. Click OK, and then in the monitor, select monitor on the right hand side, select TCP and bind, click on done. Now we had created the LDAP server. Now we'll create the service group for the storefront also. I had provided a name and I selected the protocol as SSL, because what I'm doing, my internal users will use the sf.sslab.com. So I want to do SSL. By the way, to be very frank, there is no need to do SSL here. Even you can do TCP also, but for safety reason, I'm doing SSL. Click on OK. And then select the service group members. In our case, there are two, right? Select both of them and port 443. Click OK. Now select the monitors on the right hand side. Go to the monitors. Select TCP. Select, we have to add X forward or for. Click on the settings, click edit here and select the client IP. Type X hyphen forwarded hyphen for. This is required because storefront need to know the client IP. That's why we need to do this. Then click on OK and then done. Now we are done with the service groups. Both the service groups. Now let's create the virtual servers. We'll create two virtual servers, one for LDAP, one for storefront. Click on add, provide a name and select the protocol as TCP, provide the IP, in our case it is 2.212 and 389 is the port. Click on OK, select the service group, LDAP service group, bind it, continue. Then select the persistence. For LDAP, always important, select the source-based persistence and make it 20. For LDAP, the second important thing along with source IP is the method. By default, it is least connection, but LDAP, we always recommend to do round robin. Select the method as round robin, click on OK and select the done. Now we will create the load balance virtual server for the storefront, which the internal users will connect to. Click on add. provide the storefront server name, select the protocol SSL. You can do TCP also. If you're doing TCP, you need to do TCP here and in the service group, but I'm doing SSL. Provide the IP and then click 443, select OK. Bind the service group. That's it, binding is done. Click on continue. Because we selected SSL, it will ask for certificate. Click on certificate, by the way, and click there and select the storefront certificate. I had installed the certificate already. If you want to know how to install the certificates, please refer to my blog, shivashankar.org. The details are there. Following that, you can install the certificates. Click on select and then bind. Now I had binded the storefront certificate here. Click continue. Now, the very important thing is the persistence. For storefront, it requires source-based persistence and put at least 20 minutes or more. I'll select 20 minutes, source-based persistence, and say OK. Once it is done, click on done. Right? Now, our load balancing virtual server is created, storefront is created. So, before we go to the Zen Desktop configuration, we need to do the LDAP policy, right? Because we created a virtual server here. Let's go to system, authentication, basic policies, LDAP and policies. Go to the server and then click on add. As you can see here, provide a name. I had given my domain name and then 389 port so that we can differentiate. Provide the IP of the load balancing virtual server we created, port, and then provide the base DN. In my case, my domain is sslab.com. That's why this is the base DN. And administrator DN means the service account which you require to connect to the domain. This is just a domain user. It doesn't require any permission. Just create a domain user account with a static password. That's it. I created this. This is my domain. This is the account which Netscaler will use. And put the password and click on test connectivity. Once the tests are successful, it will show you a green mark that everything is fine. Then scroll down and select here SAM account name under name, group attribute member of, and sub attribute CN. Please select these two, very important. Let's say if you don't select this member of and CN, if you are doing anything related to groups, Active Directory groups in the Netscaler, let's say you are giving admin access and other things, it don't work. So please always select not just SAM account name, it will work for VDI. But always select this member of and CN also, and then say create. Once it is created, just create a policy. So the policy, just provide a name. I provided this name and select the server that you had created now and put NS underscore true, click create. It will say classic authentication is not supported anymore. It is getting deprecated. No problem. Say okay. Now the policy is created. I generally recommend to bound this policy also to global settings. Click on global settings so that if you are using anything like giving admin access to the Netscaler and all, you can do this. Select and then say OK. Done. So it is globally bound also. It is not mandatory what I did now, but it is good if you can do it. Now let's check the DNS things. The first one, the sf.sslog.com should point to the storefront load balancer with in your DNS. And for vdi.sslab.com should point to this one. If you have different URLs, let's say if you have same URL, let's say the VDI is for internal and external both, then the internal only one you will create, it will be pointed to this. You will not point anything to the gateway because gateway generally used for external. So for external, you will do this. You will NAT your public IP to this IP and you will create a DNS record in the external pointing to the NATed IP. Now let's go and check the DNS records. Go to traffic management, DNS, records, address records. What you need to do here, there are a couple of records. You need to create a record for storefront. It's not really required, but I always recommend this to create a local host record because let's say by mistake, if your DNS communication is stopped, the authentication will fail. That's why. So I always recommend creating a record here. Click on plus sign. It will be added and say create. Just refresh the screen. The DNS record will be created. Now this is one. Second prerequisites is we need to check the SSL certificates. Go to SSL certificates, server certificates. See, I have vdi.ssl.com. I had requested and created this certificate already. If you don't know how to do this, please refer to my blog shivashankar.org. You will have the details there how to install the certificate. The VDI certificate is here and storefront certificate is here. Now let's go and configure the Zen Desktop configuration. Go down, click on ZenApp and Zen Desktop, select get started, and go to ZenApp and ZenDesktop, select Get Started. Let's say you already have a Netscaler gateway created in your environment. You will see that on the right hand side and you will say plus mark here. Click on the plus. You will get the same screen. So click on Get Started, select Storefront and continue, and then provide your URL name, the Netscaler VIP, the gateway VIP, and the always select this one. It is recommended. I'll show you later what it is doing. Actually, when you do this, there will be a HTTP record created for this URL. So by mistake, if any user in the external, they put HTTP and your URL, it will be redirected to HTTPS automatically. So click on continue. Now, next thing is it is asking for certificate. Use existing certificate, select VDI SSLab, say continue. Now it is asking for your storefront URL, provide the storefront URL. So we have provided the URL, HTTPS, sf.ssl.com, click on retrieve stores, it will retrieve the stores. Once we click on retrieve store, it retrieve the store, you select the drop down menu and select your store name. My store name is citrix/storeweb. Then default Active Directory domain name, mine is sslab.com. By the way, this name should be same here and in the storefront also. Please remember, in the storefront you can access, you can add the authentication methods. So please add the same name here in the storefront. And now I will add my the STS. I will add my STS. I am using just HTTP because generally I don't see any need for using HTTPS for STA. If you want to do it, just install a certificate, domain based certificate on the STA, put HTTPS here. That's it. It will work. That's it. I have only one and click continue. Now, because it is asking you to create new one, I generally don't recommend this. Use existing, because we already created a one, you know, it will show you that one here, right? This is the one we already created, LDAP one. Select that. By the way, it has some bug. You don't share the name, it will show the IP. So just you need to select, you know, and check here. So whatever we have created, it is showing here. Click on continue. This is for LDAP authentication. Now, as you can see here, the ZenDesktop configuration is very simple. Four things. First, gateway settings, which is your URL name and the virtual IP. Second is server certificate, which you had given. Third is storefront server details and the STA details. That's it. Then fourth thing is authentication. Now click done. As you can see here, the STS are up, storefront server showing up, the VDI service is showing up. Now with this, the configuration is done. Everyone thinks it is done, right? But if you want to do changes, you can come back here, click on edit, and you can always change whatever you want here. But this is very easy way, right, of doing changing it. But I will not show you here. I will show you now every single detail that this ZenDesktop configuration has created, right? Citrix gateway, virtual servers. This is the virtual server, the ZenDesktop that we had created, you know, 192.168.2.214. By default, it will use this naming convention. Click on here. So as you can see here, our Netscaler details are here and the certificate. You click on the certificate, you see the certificate we attached there are here. If you want to change the certificate in future, you can come here and change it here. Now, this is one. Second is basic authentication. Click on LDAP policy. See, the LDAP one we had attached in the fourth step, this is where it is. You know, the priority is zero, means this is first preference, you know. So this is where you will have the LDAP policy. If you want to see the actual policy or thing, click on edit policy to see the policy, click on edit server. If you want to see the actual LDAP server, if you want to test your LDAP is working, click on test LDAP connectivity from here only. You don't need to go anywhere. See, it is up. Means your LDAP is working fine, right? Authentication should work fine. Then after LDAP, you know, there is no SAML LDAP here. The SSL parameters. We'll go to the SSL parameters little later. So generally, you know, it will show you DH parameters and, you know, what is SSL V3, and by default SSL V3, TLS 1, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, everything is used. But ZenDesktop can work with 1.2, you know, the latest one, SSL ciphers. SSL ciphers are nothing but what ciphers it will use. Default, everything is there. Just stay tuned till the last, after 5 minutes, we'll discuss these ciphers in detail. Profiles, this is very important. I will show you. It will create two SSL profiles, you know, the net profiles. It's just for default profiles and ECC curves. ECC curves is nothing but whatever the ECC are there. This is, you know, the default ones. It will be added here. And if you want to see what is your STA servers, by mistake, let's say in that previous screen, you gave some wrong STA, or if you want to see the STA, actual what is your STA ID, you come, you click on that STA, you will see your STA here. You can actually change, add binding, you can add the new one, IPv4, and you can change it also, you know, you can unbind this. You, if the state is showing up, means we are good. Now, the cache policies, there will be six cache policies which are created, you know, just this is for you know, VPN features and you know, Netscaler, we can, you know, via web front and other things. This is for caching. The main important thing in Netscaler that everyone should know is the session policies. Now click on session policy. There are two session policies, right? One is called PSOS, PSWB. Always remember, whenever they say OS, means you have Citrix receiver installed on the user. You know, actually Citrix receiver required even if you're going for web, but you know, right, you can access VDI in two ways. One, through Citrix receiver, means in the receiver itself you will configure, like for thin clients and other things, they will go through this. The second one is the web. You are going to that URL, right? And you'll use, this is that one, means not receiver dot not, means it is using web. So the policies more or less look same, but it is bit different, and it is in the session profile. I can edit, click on edit and edit the profile here also, but I'll show you a different way from where you can access this. Click on done. All the session policies and profiles are created under Citrix Gateway policies and under session, you know, they are actually created here. So I generally recommend coming here because you'll get a full view. So these are the policies. It is receiver, receiver not. For receiver, it is same ACOS, AC web. Now let's say, what is ACOS? As I said, ACOS is for if you are coming from receiver directly or from mobile, you know, you configured inside mobile, or you did, you know, you are doing using a thin client. So this profile will be used. Click on this, select edit. This is very important. Network configuration, there is nothing. Client experience, by the way, clientless access means if you have a clientless access, you know, is off. If you want to enable it, you can do it here. And you know, plugin type is Java, right? And you see single sign on to web applications. So this is important. So what it is trying to tell is, whenever the Netscaler authenticate, if you don't select this, you know what happens? It will not sign into the backend servers. That's as simple as like that, you know. So, and override global means global settings will be overridden. So this is the thing under client experience. Security, see, default authorization action, allow, right? Published application, see, ICA proxy is on. This is very important, guys. The main important thing under session policy is only this page, published application. Others are not really important. This one, as you can see here, ICA proxy is on, means you are doing ICA proxy on the Netscaler. If it is off, it will not work, right? And another thing, how to change your storefront URL which you have given? It's very simple. Come here and do it. You know, go to the session policy, go to the published application, web interface address. This is the session policy, right? You can see here. So if you, sometimes you cannot edit because it is grayed out. If it is grayed out, click on here, override global. Then it will allow you to edit. So now you want to change to HTTPS to HTTP, you can change here. Or if you want to change, let's say your, sometimes, you know, you change the store, right? Store name. No need to go there. You come here, you do it. You know, web interface type is IP4. See, you had typed sslab.com, you remember, in the configuration. This is where it is saved. And another thing is, account service address is sf.sslab.com. This is the actually storefront URL. Now, remote desktop, nothing, PC over IP. PC over IP is for Horizon. This is what it is there, right? Click close. Now, let's go to the second one, where you are coming from web, not from actual directly from receiver. Client experience. See, clientless access off here also. Java. See, these settings are more or less same for the first one and second one, right? You will see only, you know, security is same, published application. Only difference you will see here. Have you noticed the difference between that one and this one? The only difference these two policies is this. Account service address will not be there here. Why? Why it is required there? Because let's say you added the account service URL, you put a URL here. When you configure in your mobile or iPad, you know, using Netscaler Gateway, you remember that name it will show, the URL. This is the URL if you show there. You know, if you put sf.sslab.com, it will not show VDI, even though you configured with EDI, you know, in the receiver inside VCR, it will not show you. It will show you SF. This is the place from where it will pick it. So the same thing, others, if you want to change, change it. ICA proxy is on, and others are nothing. This is for RDP proxy. This is for VMware Horizon. Click on close, right? We are trying to test it. I put vdi.sslab.com. You know, by default, it will give you this old screen with black things and all. So no one likes this, right? You need to change it. So what we need to do, we need to go to the Netscaler, you know, we need to create a theme. Click on Netscaler Citrix Gateway, portal themes, you know, click on add, provide a name, and then from the theme template, see RFUI is the old one, select always X1. X1 looks good, you know. But if you have any two-factor authentication and other things, integrations, I prefer going for Greenbubble, because Greenbubble looks good for two-factor authentication solution if you have integrated rather than X1. Click on X1, click OK. It gave you all the default things, right? So what I will do, the background color stuff and all it is asking. See, I will not change most of the things here. I will leave it to default. Only thing I'll change here is background image, right? So click on here, edit, and then choose file. Click on local, BG image. I had selected the image. I'll say OK. If you want to do any change in any colors, if you don't like any colors, if you want to change it, please come here, click on edit and do it. Click OK and say done. You can always change it. Come back here and change it. Citrix Gateway, portal themes, and select the theme and change it. Now I'll go to my Netscaler. This is my Netscaler, right? Gateway for the VDI. I click on it. On the right hand side, there is something called portal themes. Select it and drop down. Select my SSLab custom theme. OK, done. Now let's go and check it. Just refresh it. Boom, you have it. See, my background image is changed. This is the name. By the way, you can change all these things. User can log in with their username password. If you have two-factor authentication, how to integrate? This is another question, right? Create a policy for the two-factor authentication, RSA, in the system. Then come here, select your VDI gateway, and come to the basic authentication. Click on plus sign here, and not local, create radius. So the radius one will show here. If you want to do them, see, there are two ways, right? If you want to do this soft token, select primary, means you will put soft token in the first page only. Means here you will have, let's say I'll select, you know, if you select a soft token, what happens? Username, password, and password 2, the second one will show here. Let's say you don't want that, you know, you want to have it as a SMS in the next page, then it will become secondary, you know. So that's it. I don't have it. So currently I'm not saying that. Only the final thing which is pending is the hardening, security hardening of Zendesktop Netscaler, you know, configuration. Now how to do it? To go through this, scoring A+ in SSLab, this is very good. Please go through it. For configuring the Cypher suits, I always recommend going to PuTTY of the Netscaler. Log into Netscaler using PuTTY. Because with the UI, it will be very difficult. I have it copied all my suits here with the name, you know, add SSL, cipher name, and all the ciphers, I'm binding it to it. Just click here and it is saying done. Once it is done, select save config. So the configuration will be saved. Now the cipher suit is created. Go to Netscaler, configuration, Zendesktop. There are a couple of things regarding security we need to do here. One is cipher suits. Second is, see, enable DH parameter. This is not there. This is another important thing. We have to enable it. I'll show you now. Third thing is we have to disable SSL v3, TLS1 and 1.1. These are not required. Zendesktop require only 1.2. And the third thing is we need STS header. Always remember four important things. First, SSL ciphers, DH parameter, STS header, and the SSL TLS versions. Click edit here and then unselect SSL v3, TLS 1.1, TLS 1. Just select only TLS 1.2. Click on OK. That's it. I will show you how to do this later using command line. Now click on SSL ciphers. Click on edit. The UI has a bug. So if you want to delete and add at one point, it don't work. So remove first and then say OK. Now what happens is there is no SSL cipher. Then click on add. Go to cipher groups. Select the group you had created now. My group name is strong SSL ciphers. You know, that's what we run the command, right? Strong SSL ciphers. So the group I have selected, that's it. Now what I have done, two things I have finished. The remaining two things I will show you now, STS and other things. For that, I need the server name. Copy the server name. I had copied the commands here. So what I will do, I'll just paste the name of the server here, you know. By the way, these I'm taking from that same one, so you can refer to that. So So what this command will do, it will enable STS header. And what this command will create a DH parameter, the DH key of 2048, which will be strong, and this will enable it. So now let's run all the three commands one shot. Go here, done. Generally, the DH parameter creation will take time. Now the DH param key has been created. Generally, it takes some time. Please be patient. Sometimes it takes like 10-15 minutes or more than that. It depends on the configuration. If it is physical appliance, it takes less time. YPX, it takes even more time. Type the save config and click done. Once it is done, let's go and check it. Go to the Netscaler, just refresh once because sometimes you need to see that. Click on your Zendesktop. Then as you can see here, enable DHparam, it is enabled now, right? The file name is dhkeyssslab. You remember that before it is disabled. So it is done. The STS header is also done. So thank you guys. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed this video. Please like it and subscribe to the channel and share with your friends. And most important thing is please complete all the videos part of this training. It will be really helpful. Thank you.